Utopia is an approach to fluid responsive design. We started developing it as a side project about 3 years ago at Clearleft, a human-centered design studio in Brighton. In a nutshell, Utopia is an approach which helps us to elegantly scale type and space without breakpoints. We're here to talk about how and why you might want to do that. Why the name Utopia? Well, before we named this collection of ideas, we found them really quite hard to communicate. Anytime we tried to describe what we wanted to do, it sounded too complicated and too grandiose. We knew we needed to call it something, and Utopia was the big and serious sounding joke name that just ended up sticking. In practice, we think it's actually quite straightforward, and by the end of this video, we hope you'll agree. Although what we'll describe is a way to scale type and space without breakpoints, there is more to it than that. It's about improving the way design teams, including developers, can work together by increasing clarity and reducing friction. Type and space are two of the most fundamental elements of design. Near enough 100% of websites employ some combination of the two, so you could say they're quite important. The two primary components of utopian thinking are fluid type scales and fluid space scales. These form the basis for how we work with type and space in our responsive designs. In 2010, Ethan Marcotte coined the term responsive web design in his article For a List Apart. He kicked off the piece with a quote from John Alsop, which still holds true today, although that was written way back in the year 2000. He said, "We should embrace the fact that the web doesn't have the same constraints as the printed page, and design for this flexibility. But first we must accept the ebb and flow of things." And this is the thrust of Ethan's article. Rather than tailoring disconnected designs to each of an ever-increasing number of web devices, we can treat them as facets of the same experience. At the time the article was published, some websites had started to introduce mobile versions completely separate from their desktop or full versions. This fragmentation was not embracing the ebb and flow. Utopia originally emerged as a solution to a problem with type. So let's travel back in time a few hundred years and have a look at the traditional typographic scale from the days of movable type and print typography. Fonts were cast in metal, mostly, and available in a limited number of sizes, measured in points and picas. You might recognise these as the preset options in word processing or desktop publishing software. Google Docs, for example, still offers most of these as selectable options, which these days you can of course override with a custom number. The background image here is taken from the typographer's Bible, known as The Elements of Typographic Style by Robert Bringhurst. In that book, Bringhurst says, "A modular scale, like a musical scale, is a prearranged set of harmonious proportions. Although in modern digital design we can set type at any size or fraction we choose, designers often still compose type to a scale to ensure consistency and harmony and help establish a clear information hierarchy." Online tools have existed for years to calculate and visualize typographic scales. This is one I used to use daily, typescale.com by Jeremy Church. You pick a base font size and a multiplier, and the tool generates a palette of proportional font sizes to use in your design. It's up to the designer to set the font, size, and scale according to each project's content, audience, and style. Here's an example of a real-world responsive web page design with two separate type scales. One designed for small screens and one designed for large screens. So instead of serving separate websites for different device types, these page elements are facets of the same experience, or in other words, the exact same chunk of HTML throughout the viewport range. At some viewport size between small and large is a point where one type scale is swapped for the other. This approach is quite blunt and can result in undesirable layouts, especially when a viewport is just a bit narrower than the nearest breakpoint. We might end up with a relatively small device showing a typographic scale designed for a larger screen, or two similar devices unintentionally showing quite different layouts. The common solution to this problem today would be to define more breakpoints to exert more control. I would describe that as another form of fragmentation. Remember, we want to embrace the ebb and flow. These are the technical ingredients of responsive web design according to Ethan Marcotte's article: fluid grids, flexible images, and media queries. We're building on those ingredients to describe fluid responsive design. We've broadened the first point to include all space elements, and we've added fluid type sizes as a new ingredient. These ideas had been buzzing around in my head since I started working with ClearLeft in 2016. One of the projects where they started to come into focus was this publishing platform. We wanted to design a system to handle fluid interpolation between two typographic scales, one for small screens, one for large screens. The design should feel at home on any device in between, without us needing to anticipate what those devices might be. Our goal was to give every visitor the perfect reading experience. On that project, we created a calculator to keep track of our font sizes at various viewport widths. We were still using breakpoints to control layout, hence the tabs along the bottom. Design tools weren't, and still aren't, set up to deal with fluid type scales, so we manually created sketch styles for each text element at each viewport width, based on the values generated by this calculator. So this calculator was the alpha version of Utopia. It's manual, it's messy, it's not particularly elegant, but it all boils down to three pairs of values, or six numbers, to create a scalable type system to control all type sizes on all devices across your entire product. Here we specify a viewport size, a base or body font size, and a type scale multiplier, and for each of those we define min and max values. These values will all be determined by your product's content, audience, and style, and you can continue to tweak them during the design process to find the perfect balance for your unique project. This graphic marked a pivotal moment in the development of Utopia. It's a visualization of the same value set, as well as how those values relate to each other. Each column of white dots represents our fluid type scale at one particular viewport width. This scale happens to have 5 steps, but it could have any number of positive and negative steps. On the left, at a viewport width of 320 pixels, the type scale multiplier is 1.2, and the values are relatively close together. On the right, at a width of 1500 pixels, the multiplier is 1.33, and the steps are further apart, representing a more dramatic type scale like you'd typically see on a bigger screen. What we now get for free is a bespoke type scale for every possible viewport width between our min and max. In this example, I've plotted a line at 1024 pixels and printed the values the browser has calculated at that width. You could plot a line anywhere within the range and the typographic scale would always be in tune with itself. This is a simple layout to show how that can translate into design. The left frame shows a 320 pixel wide viewport with a base type size of 17 pixels and a type scale multiplier of 1.2. The right frame shows a 1500 pixel wide viewport with a base type size of 20 pixels and a type scale multiplier of 1.33. Between those two, the typographic scale at 1024 pixels was designed by the calculation and is automatically in tune. Mobile layouts tend to use smaller scale multipliers because screen space is limited, whereas desktop displays have much more space available, and therefore the opportunity to use more dramatic type scales where appropriate. Using this approach, we can automatically take advantage of space as it becomes available. This type scale interpolation can give us control of all of the text in our product with only a handful of values and some very neat CSS. Now, only designers sit there resizing browser windows to marvel at their responsive behavior, but hopefully this example shows that no matter your viewport width, the typography will always look appropriate.
To make it easy to get started, we've created a calculator and code generator on utopia.fyi. By passing in those six values we mentioned earlier, shown here on the left in the blue bar, the calculator not only works out the type sizes for you, it also generates the CSS you'll need to apply it. This CSS does look a little bit complex still, but it's foundational and it's rarely seen. Most usage of Utopia looks like this. That's it. A font size declaration and a custom property value, all written out in plain English rather than passing magic numbers around. Under the hood, this is doing some complex stuff, interpolating between, say, 23 and 58 pixels across the two viewports and capping off at a max size to stop the type from growing forever. But from a user's perspective, where the user is the developer, it's just a case of popping in font size var step 4. In fact, we really don't want the developer to care about whether it's growing to 58 or 60 pixels. If the designer is using Utopia, and they're using a style of step 4, that's all the developer needs to know about. And this works in practice. This was one of the first projects we used Utopia on, for the Natural History Museum's Wildlife Photographer of the Year website. We've used it on many projects since, and most excitingly, we've seen people in the community begin to pick up Utopia and weave it into their design process. During that project with the Natural History Museum, we started thinking about new systematic ways of dealing with space. Now, space units aren't a new concept. Many more mature design systems have the idea of visualized small, medium, large spaces that can be used to space out and lay out components. So taking the fluid typography concepts as a starting point, we began applying them to spacing units. This image shows the same component at a minimum and a maximum viewport. And rather than jumping at a certain breakpoint, the space fluidly interpolates between the two. In isolation, this might not be too impressive, but across a whole page, the difference is clear. In this example, the green represents padding and the orange represents margin. Each piece of space is accounted for and totally fluid, keeping everything in tune regardless of the screen size. Multipliers are handled slightly differently with space. Instead of stepping up and down from the base value via a set modular scale, we found we needed finer grain control. We arrived at a default but customizable set of multipliers to provide enough options for all types of space, because the idea is that every single space in the design corresponds to one of these tokens. Each token is responsive, subtly flexing between its min and max size through the viewport range. But in addition, you can generate space value pairs with Utopia. These allow space to flex between more dramatic values as required. On the left are a set of single step pairs, say small to medium, medium to large, large to extra large. And on the right are custom pairs, which are useful for things like padding text on a hero image or section spacing, all with a single custom property and no jarring breakpoints. Again, we've created the CSS generator required to use these spaces in your projects. We've even created a clamp version of both generators to vastly reduce the amount of boilerplate code. And it's just as easy to use these space tokens as it is the typographic ones. These custom properties can be used for padding, margins, transform, grid gaps, or borders, basically anything that currently accepts a pixel or a rem. The space units are written out clearly, so this is a custom space pair between small and large. You'll see there are no media queries required when using the token. This is all handled at the foundation level. And there are no magic numbers to be seen, so no awkward discussions with your designers as to why something is 10 pixels away in one place and 13 pixels away in another. The idea of shared language is at the heart of Utopia. Here are a few clips of Utopia in action. Hopefully, you can see through these just how much the content breathes into the available space. Some of these demos are more dramatic, but many just showcase good, clean typography with simple, systematic design and space. What's really nice is that we didn't design most of these sites. Other designers and developers have seen Utopia online and have implemented it into their design process, which is incredibly heartening. And people seem to get it. We've been really surprised at the response we've had to Utopia. In some ways, it feels like a real niche of a niche. But in other ways, it's universal. Every website has space and typography. They kind of are the fundamentals in design, so this really can apply to any project. And even if the responsive drama is subtle, just thinking in terms of scales and steps and sharing that language between developers and designers is so helpful. We were invited to write an article for Smashing magazine outlining this approach to fluid responsive design. This would be a decent place to start reading if you want to know more about Utopia and this approach. And we have a few principles we live by. Number one, we respect user preferences. Utopian values can be overridden by browser and user preferences, and by their nature, they respect the screen size that they are on. Number two, they're device agnostic. We don't need breakpoints to tailor designs for specific devices. Number three, they leverage technology. They let computers do what they're good at, maths. Number four, they're declarative, like CSS. Utopia works in the same way as CSS was originally designed. Rather than dictate the exact font size you'd like, you let the browser decide what's most appropriate at runtime. And number 5, they use a mindset of progressive enhancement. You opt into Utopia per element using a custom property, rather than letting a system dictate a dogmatic way of working.
There are some potential challenges to this approach. It's a more abstract way of thinking than some of us are used to and can therefore be tricky to communicate. Defining a system of variables sounds more maths homework than creative expression. It's also not an immediately intuitive way to work for all designers. What we consider embracing the ebb and flow could feel more like relinquishing control, which might make some people uncomfortable. Laying systematic foundations as you work can slow down visible progress. This is a risk early in the process, but thinking systematically can dramatically speed things up later on. Finally, there's a risk this could be seen as a substitute for skilled design. A cursory glance at our articles and tools might give the incorrect impression that this is a plug-and-play automated system. But you still need designers and developers who understand what's going on behind the scenes and are able to implement it, manage it, and talk about it. The benefits of working this way, though, can be quite dramatic. Firstly, it can increase efficiency. Because the system is central in the design process and more decisions are made globally, we've found that far fewer Figma mockups are required to communicate design decisions. And although the first page you design this way might take days or weeks, the second might be finished in an afternoon, and it can quickly start to feel like the pages are designing themselves. It can also streamline collaboration between design and development roles. By establishing a common language and a number of agreed options to build with, designers and developers stay aligned. I liken it to designing on rails, but you have complete control over those rails. Designer and developer can design in parallel, informing and steering each other. It promotes systematic thinking. Designing palettes for type and space values makes every subsequent decision more straightforward. Every element incorporates the same foundational values, which encourages holistic thinking. It also helps to ensure visual harmony and consistency. Defining these sets of values at a global level in exactly the same way you would with brand colours and fonts means that every component and every layout will be painted with the same brush and held together with the same glue. Your product or design will feel like it has a cohesive system underpinning it, because it does. So now that the type and space calculators and CSS generators are online and making our lives easier, we've been thinking about what else we can do to help people understand and use these concepts. We've published 2 Figma plugins to help designers get new Utopian projects off the ground quickly. Together, these automate some of the repetitive manual steps of setting up the initial type styles and space components in your Figma files. And we've just added a showcase to the Utopia website to share real-world evidence of Utopia in action. And there's a link on the page to submit your own Utopian projects for inclusion. In addition to the Smashing Magazine article, the website has a blog where we each attempt to clarify and formalize our thinking on this approach. And if you want to get in touch or stay up to date with Utopian development, you can find us both on Twitter or email us via the website utopia.fyi. Thanks for watching.